Hi, welcome to another lecture in this online course on advanced biblical theology. I'm Dr. Layton Talbert, and I have been teaching theology and exposition courses at Bob Jones University Seminary since 2001. And this is going to be the first of two lectures that are related to a biblical theology of the covenants. The first is titled The Covenants, Abrahamic, Davidic, and New. And lecture two will be a dispensational theological case for the fulfillment of the new covenant to Israel as Israel. And you should have access to an abbreviated outline version of the notes, which may be helpful for following along, as well as maybe inserting some additional notes that you may want to add as we work through the material. So let me start here, very basically. The Bible is the record of God's self-revelation to man. That divine self-revelation is primarily comprised of four kinds of communication, broadly speaking. Historical statements of fact, like the details of creation or the Exodus account from Egypt or the ministry of Christ. Secondly, timeless descriptions of reality, explaining to man the unseen spiritual realities of this world and how it works, including his being, his character, what he's like. Thirdly, ethical expectations that he has for man, laws, commandments, etc. And then prophetic assertions of what will happen in the future, his purposes, his predictions, and of what he will do in the future, warnings, promises, etc. And utilizing those categories, then, God often communicates his purposes and or his expectations in the form of covenants. What is a covenant? Covenant is a legally or morally binding contract between two or more parties. And they are basically of one of two kinds. You have unilateral or unconditional covenants. Unilateral meaning only the party initiating the covenant actually has obligations regarding the fulfillment of that covenant. You could describe marriage vows as mutual, unconditional, unilateral covenant promises, because you are promising, regardless of what the other person does, to fulfill your vows. And you've also got other descriptions of, or kinds, labels for, I should say, these unilateral or these unconditional covenants. Another term for a unilateral or unconditional covenant is a royal grant covenant. And an example of that would be the Noahic covenant in Genesis 9. We're not really going to talk about that. I'll mention that briefly later, but that would be an example of a unilateral or unconditional covenant. And then you've also got bilateral or conditional covenants. Bilateral means that both parties in the covenant relationship have obligations pertinent to that covenant's fulfillment. Bilateral or conditional covenants can be between equals, like between two humans, like Laban and Jacob in Genesis 31. They can be between unequals, like between, again, human and human, but one of those humans is on a hierarchically higher level, a king with a subject, for example. And a key example of this is what's called the suzerain vassal treaty, which is the model that functions as the basis for the Mosaic covenant. You've got a covenant, for example, also between Joshua and the Gibeonites in Joshua 9, where Joshua is clearly the one in power, in control, but still human, and making a covenant agreement with the Gibeonites, who are in a submissive, lower position than him. So, again, bilateral conditional covenants can be between equals, human and human, between unequals, human and human, where one is, for instance, a king, the other a subject. But you've also got covenants, bilateral or conditional covenants, that can be between unequals, where one of the parties is divine and the other is human. So you've got, again, God and Israel in the Mosaic covenant in Exodus 19 through 20, the entire book of Deuteronomy It has been argued, I think persuasively, that it is set up as a suzerain vassal treaty. It follows that pattern. So those are the basic covenantal kinds. The first covenant mentioned in the Bible explicitly is identified as the Noahic covenant. I mentioned that earlier, Genesis 9, which is an unconditional, a unilateral covenant made by God with all creation after the flood, in which he unilaterally promises mankind or creation has no obligation or condition to meet in order for this to be fulfilled. God unilaterally promises that he will never again destroy the earth with a flood, and that as long as the earth continues to exist, it will be regulated by regular seasons. That's the Noahic covenant. Now, some have argued that God also made a covenant with Adam in the garden in Genesis 2, or after the fall in Genesis 3. And that may be. This course is biblical theology, so we're really trying to stay focused on exactly how the Bible presents itself and its own theology. So since they're never identified as covenants, they're really outside the scope of interest for this particular set of lectures, which is designed to focus on the three major biblical covenants, which are the Abrahamic, the Davidic, and the New. We'll talk about the Mosaic as well, and work that in. But the three major promissory covenants, the three major, what I would argue, are unconditional or unilateral covenants, would be the Abrahamic, the Davidic, and the New. So let's start with the Abrahamic covenant. The Noahic covenant was a universal covenant, remember, made not just with humanity, but even with every creature for all time. Read through the description of that, and he makes it not just with people, but with the creatures as well. The Abrahamic covenant marks the beginning of God's narrowing the scope of his dealings with humanity at large to a single line. Although the Abrahamic covenant is made with a view to impacting all humanity. That's where you have all the families on the earth being blessed through the provisions of the Abrahamic covenant. Now, of course, the contextual background to all of this is both important and fascinating, but for the sake of time, I'm only going to sum up by saying that God, in free grace, chose Abraham, a 75-year-old man, married to a wife who was barren and unable to bear children, and over the next 25 years made a series of promises to him called the Abrahamic covenant. The promises did not begin to come to fruition until he was 100 years old, and which even then could only be said to have been inaugurated, not fulfilled. The fulfillment would come over the course of years and centuries and millennia. The elements of the Abrahamic covenant you can see in your version of the notes in that chart that you have. And I'll mention them briefly. You see the chart, it maps out all the different passages where the Abrahamic covenant is given, reiterated and added to, supplemented along the way from time to time. And the elements on the left-hand, in the left-hand column, refer to making him a great nation, first of all. The second element is blessing on the personal level, from God on Abram. The third element is blessing on a communal level from Abram on others. And fame is a third element that is promised in the Abrahamic covenant regarding his seed, that it would be numberless. There is the promise that he would make great nations out of Abraham's seed. And then there is, as you can see all the way across, reiterated this emphasis on the land. Part of the Abrahamic covenant is the promise of a land as an eternal possession. And then there's another element of blessing, which is reciprocal. I will bless those who bless you, and the one who curses you I will curse. And then international blessing, and you, all the families of the earth will be blessed, and your seed, all the nations of the earth will be blessed. See several references to that. And then the final element connected to the Abrahamic covenant is their predominance. And that's particularly wrapped up in the statement that your seed shall possess the gate of, literally, his enemies. So those are the elements of the Abrahamic covenant. It is called the Abrahamic covenant, but because it is made with Abraham and his seed, it is, of course, repeated both to Isaac in Genesis 26 and to Jacob in Genesis 28. Now, the single most debated element of the entire Abrahamic covenant is this issue of the land. So that's going to be an issue that we keep coming back to throughout this lecture. You have to do something with this detail, not only because it's an integral part of the Abrahamic covenant, but because it resurfaces in the Davidic covenant and it's emphasized repeatedly in the New Covenant. It doesn't go away, in other words. For example, you have another chart of the land promise in the Old Testament. And I've listed there all the references that I've come across in Genesis, Exodus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, Joshua, Judges, 1 Kings, 2 Chronicles, Nehemiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel. So it actually covers the entire chronological range of the Old Testament. I employed multiple search parameters to try to locate all the references that I could. I found over 60 references that you see listed there on the chart, but I'm pretty sure I have not found all of them. The point is that this is not a minor issue in God's covenantal relationship with Israel. It is a significant detail that keeps resurfacing in God's progressive covenantal relationship with Israel, and it's a detail you have to do something with in your theology, and we'll talk a great deal more about that as we go along. Now, one other question that sometimes surfaces about the Abrahamic covenant as a whole is whether or not it was a conditional or unconditional covenant. I have argued already, suggested already, that it's an unconditional covenant. A lot of theologians argue it's actually a conditional covenant. Some theologians say that it is conditional, but that the conditions were fulfilled already. And one version of the argument could be summed up this way. One, all the provisions of the Abrahamic covenant were originally conditional, dependent on Abraham's response to God's commands. In other words, if he just was not willing to participate or obey or cooperate at all, then the covenant is obviously off. Secondly, Abraham personally satisfied all of God's conditions by his faith and obedience. Third, consequently, in response to Abraham's faithfulness, God ratified all his promises in two stages, Genesis 15 and Genesis 22, by solemn oaths that effectively rendered each promise unconditional from that point on, thus guaranteeing their fulfillment. And then fourthly, Abraham's descendants then can forfeit their own participation in the benefits of the covenant, and perhaps even delay their fulfillment, but they can't jeopardize the covenant itself for the remnant, for those who remain within that covenantal relationship. So the major implication of conditionality, or the major implications, the major passages that suggest conditionality are Genesis 22, 15 to 18, and Genesis 26, 5. You can take a look at those if you want. I'm not going to take the time to go through those. For a discussion of those passages and the issue of conditionality or unconditionality, I'll suggest three sources for you. One is Thomas McComiskey, The Covenants of Promise, pages 64 and following. A second is Craig Blazing and Daryl Bach's work on progressive dispensationalism, page 133 and following. And then Robert Saucy, The Case for Progressive Dispensationalism, pages 40 and following. They all discuss that. And the problem that I have with making the Abrahamic covenant conditional or interpreting it as conditional, if the Abrahamic covenant is conditional, then not merely the land promises and population blessings, but even the messianic promise of blessing on all the families of the earth hang on the obedience of a single sinful mortal. So to make God's promised intention of international soteriological blessing dependent on the obedience of a single man, any man other than Christ, seems to me precarious and unnecessary. I think an unnecessary reading of the way those covenantal promises with Abraham are couched. So the Abrahamic covenant is normally dated around 2000 BC. One millennium later, around 1000 BC, God narrows his dealings still further by issuing another set of promises to one specific Abrahamic descendant named David. So we're going to turn to the Davidic covenant. And compared with the Abrahamic covenant, the Davidic covenant is simpler, mostly because it's confined to one central passage, and that is 2 Samuel 7, which I'm going to take the time to read through, get the text out on the table as we talk about it, and then we'll kind of work through some of the details. 2 Samuel chapter 7, beginning in verse 1. It came to pass, when the king was dwelling in his house, and the Lord had given him rest from all his enemies all around, that the king said to Nathan the prophet, "See now, I dwell in a house of cedar, but the ark of God dwells in tent curtains." Still the tabernacle. Then Nathan said to the king, "Go, do all that is in your heart, for the Lord is with you." But it happened that night that the word of the Lord came to Nathan, which, if I can just pause and make a passing observation, there is a difference between getting the counsel of a godly man and getting God's counsel through a godly man. Nathan's instinctive response to David was, "That's a great idea, that's a great ambition, go for it." But God comes to Nathan, his prophet, that night and says, "Wait a minute, that's not what I want him to do." So Nathan has to go to David the next day and correct himself, basically. So let me pick up in verse 5. "Go and tell my servant David," this is when the word of the Lord comes to Nathan that night, "Go and tell my servant David, thus says the Lord, would you build a house for me to dwell in? For I have not dwelt in a house since the time that I brought the children of Israel up from Egypt, even to this day. But I have moved about in a tent and in a tabernacle. Wherever I have moved about with all the children of Israel, have I ever spoken a word to anyone from all the tribes of Israel whom I commanded to shepherd my people Israel, saying, why have you not built me a house of cedar?" His point is, I don't really need this. "Yet," verse 8, "now therefore thus shall you say to my servant David, thus says the Lord of hosts, I took you from the sheepfold, from following the sheep, to rule over my people, over Israel. And I have been with you wherever you have gone, and I have cut off all your enemies from before you, and have made you a great name like the name of the great men who are on the earth. Moreover, I will appoint a place for my people Israel, and I will plant them, that they may dwell in a place of their own and move no more. Nor shall the sons of wickedness oppress them any more as previously. Since the time that I commanded judges to be over my people Israel and have caused you to rest from all your enemies, also the Lord tells you that he will make you a house." And there's clearly a play on words here. David wants to build God a house, a temple. God says, "I'm going to build you a house. Hey, I'm going to make you a dynasty," in other words. So verse 12, "When your days are fulfilled and you rest with your fathers, I will set up your seed after you, who will come from your body, and I will establish his kingdom. He shall build a house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. I will be his father, and he shall be my son. If he commits iniquity, I will chasten him with the rod of men and with the blows of the sons of men." In other words, I'll use people to chasten him. "But," verse 15, "my mercy," that's the term chesed, that's God's covenant loyalty, "my loyalty to this covenant shall not depart from him, as I took it from Saul, whom I removed before you. And your house and your kingdom shall be established forever before you. Your throne shall be established forever. According to all these words and according to all this vision, so Nathan spoke to David." So what are the specific promises of this covenant? Well, again, I think you have this chart. In chapter 7, verse 10, you've got the statement, "I'll appoint a place for you, I'll appoint a place for my people Israel, and I will plant them that they may dwell in a place of their own and move no more." The promise is a perpetual possession of land for Israel. You see the land coming up again, right out of the gate in the Davidic covenant. So the element is an eternal land. Second element, national deliverance. The promise is a perpetual deliverance of Israel from oppression. That's in chapter 7, verse 10. Nor shall the sons of wickedness oppress them anymore. Third element of the Davidic covenant, dynastic succession. The promise is a divinely granted Davidic dynasty. That's in verse 11. The Lord tells you that he will make you a house. Fourth element, Solomonic success. The promise is that Solomon's throne will be established after David is gone. That's in verse 12. And then the fifth element is the Solomonic temple. The promise is that Solomon, his son, will build the temple that David wanted to build. That's in verse 13. He shall build a house for my name. And then you've got a promise of an eternal dynasty. And the element is eternal dynasty. The promise is the Davidic dynasty will last forever. That's in verses 13 and verse 16. I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever, and your house and your kingdom shall be established forever before you. Your throne shall be established forever. Three times you've got that statement. And the last element is divine discipline, but perpetual loyalty to the covenant. The promise is that God will discipline David's dynastic descendants faithfully when they wander from him, when they disobey him. But he will never rescind his loyalty to this covenant, regardless of how bad they are, regardless of how much they depart from him. And you see examples of that fleshed out in the account of the Kings, the books of the Kings. When a Davidic heir, Ahaz, for example, wanders from God, refuses to believe God, God makes promises to him and says, for the sake of my servant David, I'm going to do this, not because you deserve it. So he deals with David's dynastic heirs. He chastens them when they disbelieve, when they disobey, but he maintains that Davidic line because of the covenant. He says this repeatedly, because of his loyalty to David and the covenant that he made with David. And that last element of divine discipline but perpetual loyalty to the covenant you see in verses 14 and 15 of chapter 7. Now, what happens next is, in the passage, that David expresses his own unworthiness, his gratitude for this gracious expression of God's favor to him and to his family, but there is no deed that David must perform for this to take place. There's no duty that he has to fulfill. There's no condition that he has to meet for this covenant to take effect. It is all of those elements that I just listed out. I'll mention them again. Eternal land for Israel, national deliverance, dynastic succession, Solomonic success, Solomonic temple, eternal dynasty, and the Davidic discipline, divine discipline, but perpetual loyalty to the covenant. All of those, without David doing anything, are unilateral, unconditional, eternal elements of this covenant. Let me pick up reading where we left off then, in verse 18 of 2 Samuel 7. Then King David went in and sat before the Lord, and he said, "Who am I, O Lord God? And what is my house that you have brought me this far? And yet this was a small thing in your sight, O Lord God. And you have also spoken of your servant's house for a great while to come. Is this the manner of man, O Lord God? Now what more can David say to you? For you, Lord God, know your servant. For your word's sake and according to your own heart, you have done all these great things to make your servant know them. Therefore you are great, O Lord God, for there is none like you, nor is there any God besides you according to all that we have heard with our ears. And who is like your people, like Israel, the one nation on the earth whom God went to redeem for himself as a people, to make for himself a name, and to do for yourself great and awesome deeds for your land," there's the land again, "before your people whom you redeemed for yourself." I lost my place. and to do for yourself great and awesome deeds for your land before your people, whom you redeemed for yourself from Egypt, the nations and their gods. Verse 24, for you have made your people Israel your very own people forever. Can I read that again? You have made your people Israel your very own people forever. We're going to see that language surface again in the New Covenant. And you, Lord, verse 24, the end, have become their God. When did God do that? When did God make Israel his people forever? He did that in the Abrahamic covenant. He initiated that, inaugurated that in the Abrahamic covenant. Now, verse 25. Now, O Lord God, the word which you have spoken concerning your servant and concerning his house, establish it forever, and do as you have said. So let your name be magnified forever, saying, the Lord of hosts is the God over Israel, and let the house of your servant David be established before you. For you, O Lord of hosts, God of Israel, have revealed this to your servant, saying, I will build you a house. See how David just keeps going over God's, rehearsing God's words and praying God's words back to him and saying, do what you've said. Therefore, into verse 27, your servant has found it in his heart to pray this prayer to you. And now, O Lord God, you are God, and your words are true. And you have promised this goodness to your servant. Now, therefore, let it please you to bless the house of your servant, that it may continue forever before you, for you, O Lord God, have spoken it. And with your blessing, let the house of your servant be blessed forever. David's reception of the covenant underscores the primary theological issue on display whenever God initiates such a covenant, and that is the absolute immutability, unchangeability, and absolute dependability of God's words. You see that in verse 21 and in verse 25 and verse 28 and in verse 29. It is highlighted repeatedly. That is what is at stake. That is what is on the line whenever God commits himself covenantally. The trustworthiness, integrity, reliability, dependability of his words. And God is a God who not only means what he says what he means. He knows how to communicate himself clearly so that he not just means what he says, but he says exactly what he means. We'll come back to that idea later as well. So in the Abrahamic covenant, God in grace chose out a man, an aged and a childless man, and promised him a seed from which he would create a nation who would be his own people forever, to whom he would give a land forever, and through whom he would bless all other nations on the earth. In the Davidic covenant, God in grace chose out a man from that line, from the seed of Abraham, and promised him an unending dynasty over that seed of Abraham in a land that they would possess forever. In addition to these unconditional and eternal covenants, God also instituted a regulatory, conditional covenant to govern his people. We call that the Sinaitic covenant or the Mosaic covenant. It will come to be called the Old Covenant once there is a new covenant to replace it and to contrast it with. But it's typically known as the Sinaitic or the Mosaic covenant. That covenant had nothing to do with making them God's people. They were that eternally by virtue of the Abrahamic covenant. It has nothing to do with keeping them, maintaining them as God's people. That's guaranteed by the Abrahamic covenant. That was already permanently settled by the Abrahamic covenant. It had nothing to do with keeping the land. Even though loss of the land and foreign captivity were promised judgments under the Mosaic covenant, their return to that land is also guaranteed under the Mosaic covenant because of because the land issue was already permanently settled by the Abrahamic covenant and later reaffirmed by the Davidic covenant. So you got a conditional covenant in the Mosaic covenant, blessing for obedience, judgment for disobedience. It is a demanding covenant. You got minute laws and multiple sacrifices and just tons of legislation to manage the conditions under which God would bless them or not as Abraham's covenant in that land. But it was also a faulty and failed covenant. In what sense it was faulty and failed, we'll discuss later, but this is why there was a need for a new covenant and why this covenant came to be known as the Old Covenant. The Old Covenant is not the Mosaic, is not the Abrahamic covenant. The Old Covenant is not the Davidic covenant. The Old Covenant is the Mosaic covenant. That's the one specifically that gets replaced by the New Covenant. And again, we'll work through that as we talk about the New Covenant, which we're going to do right now. So, the New Covenant. I began teaching New Testament theology in 2001. And have taught it at least once every year since then. And when I first formulated that course, I formed a conviction that shaped my teaching of that material ever since, and it's this. It's impossible to adequately understand New Testament theology if you don't understand what the New Testament is and why it's called the New Testament. So let's start here. The New Testament's identification as the inaugurated New Covenant. And all of that language is important for reasons that we'll talk about in the course of the lecture. We are so accustomed to referring to the parts of the Bible as the Old Testament and New Testament that many Christians have never paused to ponder why we call them that. So let's start right here. Why is the New Testament called the New Testament? Let's talk first about the noun, testament, versus covenant. Okay. What, for that matter, is a testament? And I think a common operational assumption is, on the part of many of God's people, it was for me for a long time as a young believer, the assumption is that testament is basically the equivalent of the word book or part. You got the Old Testament, that's part one, or the first book, the earlier, older part of the Bible, and the New Testament is the later, historically newer part of the Bible. And you got a statement here from F.F. Bruce in the Books and the Parchments that I think is helpful. It is, he says, in fact, unfortunate that the word testament was ever applied to the two parts of the Bible into which the Bible is divided, especially as there is a much more suitable English word which might be used, and a perfectly familiar word at that, and that's the word covenant. Basically saying we should never have, it's unfortunate that the parts of our Bible were ever called New Testament and Old Testament. They actually should be referred to as the Old Covenant and the New Covenant. Okay. So testament, we'll just talk about that term, since that's the one that's the most common to us. Testament derives from the Latin term testamentum. That's the term used in the Latin Bible to differentiate the Vetus Testamentum, Old Testament, from the Novum Testamentum. And this followed the earlier Greek Bibles, which divided into the Palaia Diatheke, the Old Covenant, and the Kaine Diatheke, the New Covenant. Diatheke is used in the Greek New Testament 33 times. And in the Greek Old Testament, about 340 times, to translate in the Old Testament the Hebrew term berith, which is the standard Hebrew term for covenant, which occurs about 256 times. Testament is an unhelpful translation because it typically conveys the idea of a last will and testament. When a person is about to die, they make out a will. It's called a testament. That's their testament. That's the typical sense or connotation that we attach to the word testament, which is not at all what the Bible has in mind when it refers to an Old Testament or a New Testament. In fact, diatheke rarely, if ever, bears that connotation. So Old Covenant and New Covenant would be much more suitable, in fact, biblical theological labels for our Bibles, the parts of our Bible. And again, let me go back to F.F. Bruce. If we think of the Bible as comprising these two collections, the books of the Old Covenant and the books of the New Covenant, we shall be well on our way to understanding what the Bible is and what it contains. The books of the Old Covenant tell how God made the necessary preparation for the sending of his Son to inaugurate the New Covenant. That's an important word, inaugurate. The books of the New Covenant tell how the Son of God came to do this and set forth the implications of the New Covenant. Both collections alike speak of Christ. It is he who gives unity to each and to both together. The former collection looks forward with hope to his appearance. The latter tells how that hope was fulfilled. You've got a number of New Testament references to covenants. Let's talk about those briefly. Diatheke, as I mentioned, occurs 33 times in the New Testament. Of those 33 times, just over half, technically over half, 33, I'm sorry, 17 of them are in the book of Hebrews. In chapters 7 through 13, most of those in chapters 8 to 9 of Hebrews. Two of those uses of diatheke are generic references to a covenant. Hebrews 9, 16 and 17. Two of those New Testament uses of diatheke are general references to Old Testament covenants. Romans 9:4, Ephesians 2:12. Five of those uses of diatheke in the New Testament refer specifically to the Abrahamic covenant. Nine of them refer specifically to the Mosaic covenant. And 16 of them refer to the New Covenant. And I think, again, in your notes, you've got the references to those, each of those uses in the New Testament of the term diatheke. Now that helps explain why it's called the New Testament. It really should be referred to as the real idea from a biblical theological standpoint is this is the new covenant that has been inaugurated. And these are the books of the new covenant. Just like all the books in the Old Covenant were the books that were written under the Mosaic covenant era. So that's why it's called the New Testament, but why then is it called the New Testament? Just because it's more recent? If so, more recent than what? So why is the New Testament called the New Testament? Let's talk about the adjective old versus new. It's not the Newer Testament, chronologically. It is the New Testament. And there is a world of difference between those two terms. The first denotes merely chronological distinction. The second, New Testament, introduces, or New Covenant, introduces us to a high-caliber theological distinction. In essence, the New Testament is the inauguration of the New Covenant. This is Jesus' whole point at the Last Supper. Matthew 26:28. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for many for the remission of sins. Mark 14:24. He said to them, this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for many. Luke 22:20. This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you. 1 Corinthians 11:25. After the same manner, he also took the cup when he had supped, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. He's talking about the new covenant that to those Jews was unmistakably a reference to Jeremiah 31, 31 and following. So, when precisely, according to Jesus, was the new covenant to be put into effect? Well, this is the words we just read were uttered at the Last Supper, the night before the crucifixion. And he mentions the cup representing his blood of the new covenant. When was his blood going to be shed? Next day, crucifixion, when he gave his life. So when precisely, according to Jesus, was the new covenant to be put into effect? At the crucifixion. And let me just make some distinction of terms here that we'll come back to. We can say that the new covenant was inaugurated in the upper room. Inaugurate means to dedicate something ceremoniously, to observe formally the beginning of. That's what Jesus was doing in at the Last Supper. The New Covenant was initiated. The Old Testament Hebrew term that's used in connection with bereath, the verb that's used is cutting a covenant. It was initiated or cut on Golgotha, at Calvary. And to initiate is to take the first actual step in a process or series of events. So it's inaugurated at the Last Supper. It's initiated at Calvary. Does that mean then that the New Covenant is fulfilled? My country, the United States, has recently elected a new president. And he was inaugurated on January 20th. Does that mean that his presidency is fulfilled? Well, no. Okay, it's just barely gotten underway. He made a lot of promises during the campaign. Does the fact that he's been inaugurated and is now president mean that all those promises have been fulfilled? Hardly. As a matter of fact, a lot of people hope that none of those promises are ever fulfilled, or that some of them are never fulfilled. That's a whole separate discussion. Okay, we won't go there. What is the difference then between a covenant's inauguration and that covenant's fulfillment? How would you know when a covenant has been fulfilled? I would suggest when all of its promissory terms have been realized. And we'll identify those promissory terms of the New Covenant in just a bit. But one passage in the New Testament goes into more detail than any other with respect to identifying and explaining the New Covenant, and that's Hebrews chapter 8. I would suggest you have that open before you so that we can, again, have the text on the table and be talking about it and looking at it as we're discussing it. If this is the New Testament, if the New Testament is the New Covenant, then what exactly is the Old Covenant that this New Covenant is replacing? That's where Hebrews 8 becomes definitive. Now, I've already told you the answer to that question, but let's pretend we don't know and kind of back up and talk about this inductively. Okay. You got a New Testament. If the New Testament is the New Covenant, then which is the Old Covenant that it's replacing? Because there's a bunch of covenants in the Old Testament. So Hebrews chapter 8, verse 6 says that now Jesus has obtained a more excellent ministry, inasmuch as he is also mediator of a better covenant, which was established on better promises. So better is automatically introducing us to a comparison here. Okay? Verse 7, for if that first covenant had been faultless, then no place would have been sought for a second. So what is the first covenant that Christ has replaced? Is it the Noahic covenant, the Abrahamic covenant, the Davidic covenant? What is it? Verse 8, because, he continues, finding fault with them, he says, behold, the days are coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. And he then begins a lengthy quotation of Jeremiah 31 introducing the new covenant. Verse 9, he continues, not according to the covenant, and he's quoting Jeremiah 31 here, not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the day when I took them by the hand to lead them out of the land of Egypt, because they did not continue in my covenant, and I disregarded them, says the Lord. So it's not like the one I made with your fathers. That's clearly going to be the old covenant that the new one is replacing. So which one is that? Is the old covenant the Abrahamic or the Davidic or, you know, one of these other covenants? The old covenant being replaced, clearly, if you look at the terms of the text, both in Jeremiah 31 and what he's saying here in Hebrews 8, quoting Jeremiah 31, the old covenant being replaced is the Sinaitic covenant. It is the Mosaic covenant. That has now become the old covenant. And we didn't really spend any time with the Mosaic or the Sinaitic covenant except to point out that it was a regulatory covenant, a conditional regulatory covenant designed to constitute those who were already his people as a nation. They were already his people by virtue of the Abrahamic covenant. The Mosaic covenant constitutes them as a nation, just like he promised in the Abrahamic covenant that they would be. and then to govern their behavior as a nation. As I mentioned before, the Mosaic Covenant was a conditional covenant, blessing for obedience, judgment for disobedience. It was a demanding covenant, minute laws, multiple sacrifices. But it was also a faulty and failed covenant. And Hebrews 8:7 just confirmed this when it stated that the first covenant was not faultless. In other words, that first old covenant was faulty or flawed. Question. How could a covenant that originated with God be flawed and in need of replacement? Look at chapter 8, verse 7 again in Hebrews. That verse implies the first covenant was faulty and in need of replacement. Chapter 8, verse 8 clarifies that it wasn't the covenant itself that was flawed. God found fault not with it, the verse says. God found fault with them. The problem with the Mosaic covenant wasn't the covenant. It was the people who couldn't keep it, couldn't live up to all the multiplied conditions that were part of this covenant. So the people were the problem, not the law, not the covenant. In fact, Romans 7, Paul argues the same thing. Is the law sin? God forbid. The law is holy. The law is just. The law is good. Everything God commanded Israel through the Mosaic covenant is entirely righteous and just. Romans 8:3, then, Paul will say, Paul will describe what the law could not do in that it was weak through the flesh. See, there we are back to the them. We're back to the people. The problem with the law, the problem with the Mosaic covenant was that it could not, well, let me rephrase it, state it the way the verse says it again. The problem with the law was it was weak through the flesh or on account of the flesh because of the people who couldn't keep it. Now, I always use an illustration here. We almost always have roast beef for Sunday dinner. It's just kind of a family tradition. And I like to be the one to cook it. Sometimes my wife does, sometimes I do. There are little things that I like to do that she doesn't always do, or that she doesn't always like to do, but I like to cook it my own way sometimes. But I put a roast in Sunday morning before we go to church. Okay? And I like to add, she likes to add marjoram, I like to add rosemary. I think rosemary is kind of the key ingredient. Little side tip here, you guys, for this online course on biblical theology, how to cook a roast properly. Rosemary is the key, and soy sauce. So, fix the roast, put it on the stove, put it on low, and we go off to church for 2 hours, 3 hours. We come back about 3.5 hours later. As soon as you walk in the door, you can smell that roast all through the house. Smells wonderful, and you are hungry. Okay, so I walk in the door. I take the lid off the pot where the roast is, and I grab a meat fork and I stick the meat fork in there. If I can pick up the roast with the fork, we have a problem. Because when I stick that fork into the roast ought to just go, it ought to just fall apart off the fork. Okay? That means the roast is ready and it's going to be really good. Okay. Now, if I stuck the fork in there and tried to pick up the roast and the roast kept falling off because it was so tender, because it was so weak, it would be ridiculous of me to blame the fork and say, this stupid meat fork, it's not working right, it won't pick up the roast. The problem's not the meat fork. The problem in this case is the roast, the weakness of the flesh. Now, in the case of the roast, it's a good thing. In the case of the law, the Mosaic Covenant, it's a bad thing. But the illustration is just trying to convey the problem is not with the law. Okay? The law is just and holy and good. The law is the meat fork. But the meat fork can't make the roast do what it wants it to do. Okay? Can't pick up the roast because it's cooked. It is weak through the flesh. Flawed illustration? Yeah, probably. But I hope it gets the idea across that the problem is not with the law itself. The problem is with the people. Just like Hebrews said, he found fault not with it. He found fault with them. Okay. Now, Hebrews 7:11, Hebrews 7:19, Hebrews 9:9, Hebrews 10:1 all convey the idea that the covenant was faulty because it could not make its participants faultless or complete or perfect is the term. Why? Because it was a purely external law that made demands on the behavior of sinners. But it was a covenant, it was a law that provided no internal enablement to live up to those demands. It's like the meat fork being stuck in the flesh, in this weak flesh, and it can't make that flesh do what it wants because of the weakness of the flesh. The law, the Mosaic Covenant, did not provide any internal enablement to live up to the demands of that covenant. Consequently, back in Hebrews chapter 8, verse 9, what does it say? Which covenant they broke. See, the problem is the people. They broke the covenant. The problem's not the covenant, it's the people. So let's continue back in Hebrews 8, verse 10. For this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my laws in their mind, and I will write them on their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. This is a whole new covenantal structure. This is not the Mosaic Covenant anymore. Mosaic Covenant comes along and just says, do this, do this, do this. Don't do this, don't do this, don't do this. And when you fail, here are the sacrifices to temporarily mend your relationship with God. But this is very temporary. This is not permanent. But in the New Covenant, this is the covenant that I'll make. Again, he's still quoting Jeremiah 31. I'll put my laws in their mind, I'll write them on their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. None of them shall teach his neighbor and his brother any more, saying, know the Lord, for they shall all know me. When the new covenant is fully in force, all the people with whom the new covenant was made, who's that? Back up in the verse in Hebrews, or look it up in Jeremiah 31:31. The house of Israel and the house of Judah. All of them will know me, from the least of them to the greatest of them. 4 verse 12, I will be merciful to their unrighteousness, and their sins and their lawless deeds I will remember no more. So this is going to be what's described as a better covenant established on better promises, because these promises will internalize and enable obedience and remove sin permanently, not just cover over it temporarily. It will enable obedience, it will remove sin permanently, and it will perfect its participants, those who are part of this covenant. Let me jump to Hebrews 10:14 for some confirmatory terminology here. Hebrews 10:14, for by one offering he, that is Christ, has perfected forever those who are being sanctified under this new covenant. But the Holy Spirit also witnesses to us, for after he said before, this is a covenant that I will make with him after those days, says the Lord, back to Jeremiah 31, he's quoting again, I will put my laws into their hearts, and in their minds I will write them. Then he adds, their sins and their lawless deeds I will remember no more. You hear the difference between these two covenants? The old one is externally demanding. The new one is internally transforming. God set them up that way. So, back to chapter 8, verse 13. In that he says a new covenant, he has made the first one, the old one, obsolete. Now, what is becoming obsolete and growing old is ready to vanish away. This is why the writer to the Hebrews gives such sobering warnings to these readers, Hebrew converts, or at least professors of Christ, because if they turn their back on this new covenant, there is nowhere else to go. There is no more hope. The old covenant can't do anyone any good. It is over, it's done with, it's obsolete, it's been replaced. you can understand a Jew's tendency to, if he's thinking about confessing Christ and going in this direction of these Christians, these Hebrews who have become followers of Christ, who they claim to be the Messiah, you can understand a Jew in that situation who begins to feel pressure and persecution and ostracism from other Jews who don't believe that, who don't want to go in that direction, who don't want you to go in that direction. You can understand the tendency to think, well, there's lots of questions here, there's persecution attached to it, maybe I should just stick with the Old Covenant because I know that came from God. I know God gave that covenant to Moses on Mount Sinai. We've been observing that covenant and offering those sacrifices and following those laws for centuries and centuries and centuries, and I know that's from God. You can understand a Jew thinking that, and the writer of Hebrews is saying, no, you can't think that way anymore because that's gone. This is God's full final word, his full final revelation. This is the new covenant that he talked about in Genesis 31. This is the final word. Hebrews 1:1. God, who in sundry times and in diverse manners spoke in times past unto the fathers by the prophets, has in these last days spoken with finality through a son. And it's the new covenant that has been put in place now. And if you turn away from that new covenant, this is what Hebrews 10 is really urging on the readers. If you turn from Christ and your confession of Christ and this new covenant, there is nothing to go back to. It's gone. Good German word here, it's kaput. It's not functioning anymore. Hebrews is the fullest New Testament expression, indicating in this passage, Hebrews 8, indicating the inauguration of the new covenant. But again, inauguration is a crucial word here. For example, in Luke 4, Jesus stood up in the Nazareth synagogue to read from Isaiah 61. And he declared that what he read was fulfilled as of that day. So here's what he read. He's reading from Isaiah 61, verses 1 to 2. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord hath anointed me to preach good tidings unto the meek. He hath sent me to bind up the brokenhearted. He sent me to proclaim liberty to the captives, and the opening of the prison to those who are bound, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord, and the day of vengeance of our God. That's how Isaiah 61:2 finishes. But where, according to Luke 4, does Jesus stop his reading of that passage? He purposefully stops reading before he gets to Isaiah's reference in the very next breath. There's not even a punctuation mark. The very next breath of Isaiah is, and the day of vengeance of our God. But Jesus stops his reading mid-sentence and does not read that last line. And then rolls up the scroll, sits down, and says, today this prophecy has been fulfilled in your ears, in your hearing. And in doing that, Jesus is demonstrating and authorizing what is referred to as a telescopic interpretation of prophetic scripture. The idea that there may be words that appear back to back in the prophecy that are in fact separated in fulfillment by centuries or even millennia in terms of actual fulfillment. Because Jesus repeatedly indicated, or not indicated, said, I haven't come to judge. Okay? The Father has committed all judgment to the Son, John 9. He talks in John 12 about the day coming when judgment would come, but that's not now. That hasn't been fulfilled. So that prophecy of Isaiah 61, 1 to 2, I would argue, because there's multiple elements of that, I would argue that it's been inaugurated, a portion of it has been fulfilled. Jesus said, today, this prophecy, the part that he read, has been fulfilled in your ears. But the rest of that prophecy, the part he did not read, is not yet fulfilled, even though it's back-to-back with the other statements in that passage. Likewise, it is significant to note where the writer of Hebrews stops quoting the New Covenant description in Jeremiah 31. Because, as we're about to see, Jeremiah goes on to describe details of the New Covenant that are not included because they're not yet operative. They're not yet fulfilled. In fact, the portion of Jeremiah 31 that the book of Hebrews cites, quotes, is what I call the preamble of the New Covenant. It's not the whole New Covenant. It would solve so many problems if we would understand that Jeremiah 31:31-34 is not the New Covenant. It's the preamble to the New Covenant. The New Covenant is far more complex, there are far more elements folded into this New Covenant that Jeremiah goes on to, or I should say that God goes on to enunciate throughout the rest of Jeremiah 31 and Jeremiah 32 and Jeremiah 33 and passages in Isaiah and passages in Ezekiel, all of which are discussing this New Covenant. Okay. So the point I'm making here is the section of the New Covenant that the writer of Hebrews quotes as being in force from Jeremiah 31:31-34, where he stops the quotation is significant. Just like where Jesus stops his quotation of Isaiah 61 in Luke 4 is significant. The rest of it hasn't been fulfilled. The entire New Covenant has not been fulfilled yet because there are so many more elements in these other New Covenant passages in the Old Testament that haven't been realized yet. We'll talk about those. Now, hopefully we understand a little bit better why the New Testament is called the New Testament or the New Covenant, what that means, what it refers to. But when did God decide that a new covenant would be needed? Maybe that's not a fair question, because God is omniscient and God always knew that a new covenant would be necessary. So let me ask the question this way. When did God first indicate that the Sinaitic covenant or the Mosaic covenant would need to be replaced? If you say Jeremiah 31, that's a good guess, but it's wrong. If you said Isaiah, because Isaiah actually wrote earlier than Jeremiah, that's a good guess, good reasoning, but you're still wrong. The first indication that the Old Covenant isn't going to work is actually folded into the Old Covenant itself. So let's go there next. Let's go from the New Testament and Hebrews 8 and the quotation of Jeremiah 31 and the New Covenant being inaugurated. Okay, let's leave all that and go back to the Old Testament, the books of the Old Covenant, and look at all those references, prophetic references to and anticipations of what we call the New Covenant. The New Covenant was first spelled out in detail by God through the prophet Jeremiah. But it was anticipated by God even before the ink was dry on Moses' writing of the Old Covenant. You got Old Covenant anticipation of a New Covenant in Deuteronomy 29. Deuteronomy is part of the Mosaic Covenant. It's the second giving of the law. So if you would look at Deuteronomy 29, beginning in verse 14. God says, Not with you alone am I making this covenant and this oath, but both with those who stand here with us today, current generation, in the presence of the Lord our God, and with those who are not with us here today. That is the future generations of the Jews. This covenant applies to them as well. They're under this Mosaic covenant. Verse 18. So that there will not be among you a man or a woman or a family or a tribe whose heart turns away today from the Lord our God to go and serve the gods of those nations, that there will not be among you a root bearing poisonous fruit and wormwood. It shall be, when he hears the words of this curse, that he will boast, saying, I have peace, though I walk in the stubbornness of my heart, in order to destroy the watered land with the dry. The Lord shall never be willing to forgive him, but rather the anger of the Lord and his jealousy will burn against that man, and every curse that is written in this book, connected to the Mosaic Covenant, will rest on him, and the Lord will blot out his name from under heaven. Talking about individuals within under the Mosaic Covenant. Verse 21, then the Lord will single him out for adversity from all the tribes of Israel according to all the curses of the covenant which are written in this book of the law. Now the generation to come, your sons who rise up after you, and the foreigner who comes from a distant land, when they see the plagues of the land and the diseases with which the Lord has afflicted it, will say, all its land, its brimstone and salt, a burning waste, unsown and unproductive, and no grass grows in it, like the overthrow of Sodom and Gomorrah, Admah and Zeboiim, which the Lord overthrew in his anger and in his wrath. And all the nations will say, why has the Lord done thus to this land? Why this great outburst of anger? Then men will say, verse 25, Deuteronomy 29, verse 25, because they forsook the covenant of the Lord, the God of their fathers, which he made with them when he brought them out of the land of Egypt. Which covenant are we talking about? Mosaic covenant. They went and served other gods and worshipped them, gods whom they have not known and whom they have not and whom he had not allotted to them. Therefore the anger of the Lord burned against that land to bring upon it every curse which is written in this book, and the Lord uprooted them from their land in great anger and in fury and in great wrath, and cast them into another land as it is this day. That doesn't sound very encouraging. It sounds as if Israel's failure and judgment is a done deal. Like, this is going to happen. When this happens, people will say this, and this will be the reason for it. It's like it's a foregone, or at least a foreknown conclusion. And if that's so, if their ability to keep this covenant is so hopeless, then they might ask, what's the point of even trying to obey? Next verse, Deuteronomy 29:29. This one you know. The secret things belong to the Lord our God, but the things revealed belong to us and to our sons forever, that we may observe all the words of this law, this Mosaic covenant. The events and the contingencies of the future belong to God alone. Their job is not to try to look into the future and figure out whether or not they will keep it or whether or not they'll be able to keep it. Those future contingencies belong to God alone. The secret things belong to the Lord. But this is what's revealed. This is the covenant we're under. This is the obligations that we have agreed to in the Mosaic covenant. God's the only one who knows what's going to happen in the future, 29:29a. What's revealed and certain is this law and Israel's welfare as long as they will obey it. That's 29:29b. And significantly, in addition, the context proceeds to affirm a recovery and a restoration of those people back to their land, out of which God is going to take them when they disobey and break this covenant. A restoration back to this land in surprisingly new covenant sounding terminology. Look at Deuteronomy chapter 30, verses 1 to 8. So it shall be when all of these things have come upon you. See, it sounds like a done deal. Sounds like they're not going to keep this covenant. God is going to have to deal with them. He, in fact, is going to drive them out of the land that he promised to give to them through the Abrahamic covenant. He's going to drive them out of the land, but, Deuteronomy 30, verse 1, it shall be when all these things have come upon you, the blessing and the curse which I have set before you, and you call them to mind in all those nations where the Lord your God has banished you, and you return to the Lord your God and obey him with all your heart and soul according to all that I command you that today, you and your sons, then the Lord your God will restore you from captivity and have compassion on you and will gather you again from all the peoples where the Lord your God has scattered you. Why is he going to do that? Just because he's good? No. He is good. But he's not going to do this just because he's good. Just because he always forgives, that's his job. He's God. God forgives. That's not what's going on here. He's going to bring them back, restore them to their land, and have compassion on them, and gather them again from all the peoples because of the Abrahamic covenant. Because of an unconditional, unilateral covenant in which he swore to do certain things for a certain people, regardless of what they do. Okay? Regardless of whether they, now again, as individuals, they can refuse to circumcise themselves or their children. They can cut themselves off from the enjoyment of the covenant, but they can't break the covenant itself. They can't prevent God from fulfilling this Abrahamic covenant. That's the basis on which he's going to do this. Deuteronomy 30, verse 4, if your outcasts are at the ends of the earth, from there the Lord your God will gather you, and from there he will bring you back. The Lord your God will bring you into the land which your fathers possessed. How did they get that land? God gave it to them through the Abrahamic covenant. And you shall possess it. And he will prosper you and multiply you more than your fathers. Moreover, the Lord your God will circumcise your heart. Does that sound like the new covenant? See, I don't know anything about the new covenant yet. We haven't talked about the new covenant yet. Trust me, it sounds like the new covenant. Okay. We already talked about how the old covenant, the Mosaic covenant, was purely external. The new covenant is internal. It transforms us internally. It puts God's law in people's hearts and writes them in their minds. Okay. So God here says, I'm going to bring you back. I'm going to have compassion. I'm going to circumcise your heart and the heart of your descendants to love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul so that you may live. Verse 8, and you shall again obey the Lord and observe all his commandments which I command you today. And it's not filled out yet because we're still back under the Mosaic covenant in Deuteronomy 30. But they're going to obey and observe all his commandments under those conditions because that's when he's going to circumcise their hearts. That's when he's going to bring in the new covenant and do this transforming work internally in them. Okay. So what you've got here in this passage, Deuteronomy 29 and 30, specifically chapter 30, is a proleptic reference to, an anticipatory reference to, and a condensed description of the new covenant. So how then can one reconcile the apparent termination of this nation in 29:20-28 and their restitution and their spiritual resuscitation? How can you reconcile these? Those are some of the secrets that belong to God alone. Deuteronomy 29:29a. But you've got an anticipation of a new covenant of a time. Let me just put it this way. You got the anticipation of a time when God is going to do something different and distinctive in their hearts. He's going to change them and transform them internally. That sets the stage for the new covenant that the prophets are going to talk about in great detail. Or I should say, that God is going to talk about in great detail through the prophets. That's a proleptic announcement of the new covenant in Deuteronomy, under the old covenant itself, within the context of the Mosaic covenant itself. Let's talk then about the prophetic announcement of the new covenant. Three major Old Testament prophets expressly relate the coming of a new covenant. Hopefully you've already read these passages. I try to build into this course the requirement that you read through all these prophetic references to the new covenant on the front end so that you familiarize yourself with them. We don't have time to read them in this forum, but reading all these new covenant passages, especially if you will do it in one sitting, is invaluable for getting a clearer and a more complete picture of the breadth of the promissory content of the new covenant. I say again, the new covenant is not Jeremiah 31, 31 to 34. That's the preamble. The new covenant is huge. The ramifications are huge. The components and elements are multiple. And in my opinion, most inadequate treatments of the new covenant arise, and this is on the part of both covenant theologians and dispensational theologians, most inadequate treatments of the new covenant arise from the failure to deal with these passages as a single body of authoritative, comprehensive material on exactly what the new covenant is and what it requires to be considered fulfilled. Now, it is true that Isaiah writes earlier than Jeremiah, but God uses the term new covenant first and only in Jeremiah. So I'm going to start there with Jeremiah. Jeremiah 31, 31 to 40, and it's referred to there as the new covenant. Jeremiah 32, 36 to 44 is described as the everlasting covenant, but he's talking about the same covenant, and that's very clear if you read those passages together. Jeremiah 33, 14 to 26, it's referred to as that good thing that I promised to the house of Israel and the house of Judah. Same terminology that he uses to introduce the new covenant in Jeremiah 31, 31. So he's talking about the same covenant, that good thing that I promised to the house of Israel and the house of Judah. Same covenant. Jeremiah 50, verses 4 and 5, it's referred to as a perpetual covenant. Now, earlier than Jeremiah, God had unfolded aspects of this new covenant, but under different descriptions, like everlasting covenant. You got that term, remember, in Jeremiah 32. And covenant of peace. Its descriptions in Isaiah make it clear, however, that it is the very same covenant that is in view in Jeremiah 31 and 32 and 33. So in Isaiah, you've got 54, 1 to 17. It's referred to as a covenant of peace. Isaiah 55, 3 to 13, that's a new covenant passage. Very famous passage, Isaiah 55. It's a new covenant passage. And the new covenant is they refer to under the term everlasting covenant. Isaiah 59, 20 to 21, it is called a covenant, but it's described in eternal terms, talking about the same covenant. Isaiah 61, 8 to 11, it's called the everlasting covenant. Now, God says a great deal more about this covenant through one more prophet. Ezekiel, though more or less contemporary, a contemporary of Jeremiah's, was prophesying to the people of God who were like him, exiled, like Ezekiel, exiled to Babylon. Just like Jeremiah said that they would be, in fact. So you've got these passages in Ezekiel, chapter 11, verses 14 to 21. There is no explicit reference to a covenant, but you've got identical descriptions in that passage that you had in the New Covenant passages in Jeremiah. Ezekiel 16, 60 to 63, it's called an everlasting covenant. Ezekiel 34, 20 to 31, is called a covenant of peace. Ezekiel 36, 16 to 38, again, there is no explicit reference to a covenant. That term doesn't show up, but you've got identical descriptions of the new covenant that you had back in Jeremiah 31 and 32 and 33. And then Ezekiel 37, 15 to 28, it's referred to as a covenant, as an everlasting covenant, as a covenant of peace. All three of those terms are found there. Now, this is fascinating, and I think I've included this in your version of the notes. This correlation, I've charted this correlation between Ezekiel 36, remember, we're looking at Ezekiel 36 as a new covenant passage, and Deuteronomy 30, that Old Testament, that Old Covenant, Mosaic reference to anticipation of a new covenant, even while, as I said, even before the ink of the Old Covenant was dry. So the comparison is fascinating. Let me start with the right hand side. Let me just work through this briefly with you. Deuteronomy 30, he says, if any of you are driven out to the farthest parts under heaven, remember this, from there the Lord your God will gather, kavats is the Hebrew term you, and there he will take you, lakach, and then the Lord your God will bring you, bo, into into the land. Those are the Hebrew terms that are used there. Look at Ezekiel 36:24. For I will take you, lakach, from among the nations. I will gather you, kavats, out of all countries, and bring you, bo, into your own land. Then I will sprinkle clean water on you, Ezekiel says, and you shall be clean. I will cleanse you from all your filthiness and from all your idols. I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit in you. I will take the heart of stone out of your flesh and give you a heart of flesh. And I will put my spirit within you, and I will cause you to walk in my statutes, and you will keep my judgments and do them. Look straight across the column at what we read already in Deuteronomy 30. Verse 6. The Lord your God will circumcise your heart and the heart of your descendants to love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul that you may live. And you will again obey the voice of the Lord and do all his commandments which I command you today. No reference to the spirit there. Okay? No reference to a new heart, but you've got the same thing going on with an internal surgical procedure, if I can put it that way, a spiritual surgical procedure that God is going to perform on the heart of these people. And they're going to obey him. And Ezekiel fills out the picture by clarifying that the way they're going to obey him is, I'm going to put my spirit within you, as well as circumcise, change, transform, convert, remake your heart. Now, in the Deuteronomy column, let's go back to Deuteronomy. The verses are a little bit out of order so that I can parallel the terminology more clearly, but the same things are being said. Look at Deuteronomy 30, verse 5. Then the Lord your God will bring you to the land which your fathers possessed, and you shall possess it. Left-hand side, Ezekiel 36, 28. Then you shall dwell in the land that I gave to your fathers. When did he give the fathers that land? Mosaic covenant? No. Abrahamic covenant. He promised Abraham and his seed would have a land forever. And let's continue with Ezekiel 36:29. I will deliver you from all your uncleannesses. I will call for the grain and multiply it and bring no famine upon you. And I will multiply the fruit of your trees and the increase of your fields so that you need never again bear the reproach of famine among the nations. Right across the column. Back in Deuteronomy 30, here's what he said. He will prosper you and multiply you more than your fathers. You see the verbal correlations here. The Lord your God will make you abound in all the work of your hand, in the fruit of your body, in the increase of your livestock, and in the produce of your land for good. For the Lord will again rejoice over you for good as he rejoiced over your fathers. And then you've got the same statement that you've got at the beginning of Deuteronomy 30. With those three Hebrew verbs, God will gather you, kavats, and from there, and he will take you, lakach, and the Lord will bring you to the land, bo. You've got that book ending, the Ezekiel section. You've got it in Ezekiel 36:24, and it shows up again in Ezekiel 37:21. Surely I will take you, I will take the children of Israel, lakach, from among the nations, wherever they have gone. And will gather them, kavats, from every side, and bring them, bo, into their land. Correlation between those two passages is absolutely, I think, fascinating. And it verifies, I would argue, what I said about Deuteronomy 30 as proleptic or anticipatory of the New Covenant, even though the New Covenant itself is not mentioned there by name. Now, there are, of course, other prophetic references to the New Covenant as well. In Hosea and elsewhere. These are the major passages on the New Covenant in the Old Testament. So you've got a chart here. And one of the most valuable things I have done in my understanding of this whole topic is take the time to work through all those prophetic passages on the New Covenant and isolate every single thing that God says he will do as part of this new covenant. So you've got this chart of the components of the new covenant. The wording I have tried to make intentionally precise according to the terms of the text. This is biblical theology, okay? This is not about saying things in my own words. This is trying to to notice and recognize in the text what the text says and use the text's own language to describe what's being talked about. They are listed in order as they appear, beginning with what I call the locus classicus of the New Covenant, which is Jeremiah 31, 31 and following. So, when you look at that passage, what's the object? With whom is the covenant made? The object is expressed in Jeremiah 31 as the house of Israel and the house of Judah. It is described in 33:26 of Jeremiah as the descendants of Jacob and David. It is described in Jeremiah 33:26 as the descendants of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob. Okay. You've got three very precise identifications of who the recipients of this covenant are in Jeremiah 31 to 33. So what are the components? The first one is God's law is going to be internalized, Jeremiah 31, 33. Secondly, God will be their God and they will be his people. And that's reiterated in Ezekiel and other passages as well. Thirdly, there will be a nationwide, I'll come back to that, this is very important, a nationwide individual knowledge of God. Every individual in the nation will know God when this covenant is fully in effect. Fourth, there will be a cleansing from sin. Iniquity will be forgiven, and sin will be eternally forgotten. That's in Jeremiah as well as Ezekiel and other passages. The fifth component is the eternal existence of Israel as God's nation and God's covenant people with an oath. The oath is very important. We'll come back to that as well. Sixth component, Jerusalem was going to be rebuilt and prosperous and eternally secure. Not going to be overthrown anymore. Seventh component is a universal regathering of Israel from all the nations. Eighth component, permanent restoration to the land given to their fathers. Ninth component, a sovereign spiritual operation internally enabling them to obey and securing their loyalty to him forever. Tenth component, God will never turn away from blessing them. 11th component, Israel will be known for its righteousness, a righteousness that they will receive from God. 12th component, the perpetuity of the Davidic line is reasserted with an oath. 13th component, you ready for this? Got to do something with this. This is a new covenant promise. The perpetuity of the Levitical line is reasserted with an oath. Back to back, same breath as the Davidic line is reasserted with an oath. The perpetuity of the Levitical line is reasserted with an oath. That's a separate discussion, how that works. Can't get into that in this lecture or the next lecture. But that's something that needs to be thought through. 14th component, God's Spirit will be indwelling these people, these to whom he has made the new covenant. 15th component, Israel and Judah will be reunited into one nation. Remember Jeremiah 31, when the covenant is made, they're two separate nations. You've got the northern kingdom, the southern kingdom, Judah and Israel. They were divided after David. And part of the new covenant is they're going to be reunited into a single kingdom. 16th component is the establishment of David as Israel's prince. 17th component involves a humbling remembrance of their past sin. They will remember their sin and it will humble them and they'll be embarrassed and grieve because of their sin, their past sin. 18th component, Israel will be rebuilt and fruitful and eternally secure. Not just Jerusalem, but Israel. Okay. The land will be rebuilt and fruitful and eternally secure from invaders and anything else. 19th component, a universal recognition on the part of all the other nations. They will recognize Israel as uniquely blessed by God. That language is in Ezekiel 36 and Ezekiel 37 and Isaiah 61. All through, in fact, Isaiah 61. The 19th component is the universal recognition of Israel. I just said that, as uniquely blessed by God. 20th component, sorry about that. See, there's so many, I'm getting lost. The 20th component, Israel's international rejection and abuse will be forever reversed. And frankly, that's something you can look around the nations today. Israel is still rejected by the nations. Israel is still a persona non grata in the United Nations. They have a couple of friends, the United States being one. Britain, France most of the time, but the vast majority of the world's nations, particularly the nations right around Israel, but not by any means limited to that, the majority of the world's nations are opposed to Israel. And that's going to be reversed. And it's going to be reversed forever. That abuse is going to be reversed forever. 21st component, Israel will be the center of international attention and wealth and worship. 22nd component, any nation that will not honor Israel is going to be punished. That's interesting. That's got to be factored in to what you do with the new covenant. That, in fact, is going to be, I'll just throw this little sideline hint in at this point. That's one reason why it's hard to argue for the new covenant being fulfilled in the new earth, ultimately completely fulfilled in the new earth, because there are really going to be other nations in the glorified new earth that will not honor Israel and therefore have to be punished. 23rd component, God's presence, his sanctuary will be in their midst forever. And the 24th, God will be their eternal light, replacing the sun and the moon. There, you finally got this merging into the new heavens and the new earth. The motive for all of this, what's the motive for the new covenant? Why is God instigating this or instituting this new covenant? The motive is the universally restored sanctification of God's holy name. That's expressed in Ezekiel 36. So that he may be glorified. It has nothing to do with Israel deserving this. Just like the Abrahamic covenant to begin with, just like the Davidic covenant that follows, the new covenant, all of this targets Israel by God's free, pure, good grace. Now, a few notes on that whole chart of the components of the new covenant. And there may be others. I've gotten all that I have found, that I have noted as distinct components of the new covenant in all these new covenant passages. There may be others, but that's all that I'm aware of at the present. Now, some notes. All of these are not fulfilled in the New Testament. Clearly. Okay. In fact, only a handful of these have New Testament confirmation as applicable in some sense to New Testament believers, even Gentile believers. But the presence of that handful, and I've got the chart coded to tip you off to which ones of these are referred to as being experiences of the New Testament believer. The fact that you've got a small handful of New Covenant components that are in fact fulfilled and, I should say, enjoyed by New Testament believers underscores the conspicuous absence of the vast majority of the New Covenant promises that are never mentioned in the New Testament, let alone described as having been fulfilled. So, for example, if the New Covenant is fulfilled in the church, as the standard covenant theological argument would be, if the New Covenant is fulfilled in the church, how does one interpret component number 10, or component number 11, or component 13, or component 14? How can you argue? Where do you go for scripture that verifies? Where do you go for scripture that even clearly parallels or makes any reference to the fulfillment of some of those components in the New Covenant? Number 10 is nationwide individual knowledge of God. Right? Oh, no, it's not. Oh, dear. I got the wrong numbers here. Hold on. Let me pause you for a second. Okay, sorry about that. Here's the note as it reads in your version, your notes. Only about five of the components, and I list them out there, I think, numbers 1, 2, 4, 9, and 14, are cited in the New Testament as applicable in some sense to New Testament believers. The presence of these in the New Testament underscores the conspicuous absence of the vast majority of the other New Covenant promises that are never mentioned in the New Testament, let alone described as fulfilled. So, if the New Covenant is fulfilled in the church, how then does one interpret the components such as number three, nationwide, individual knowledge of God? All Israel will know him. How do you translate that into the church, fulfillment in the church? The church is not a nation. There's certainly not universal individual knowledge. In fact, even within our churches, there is not universal knowledge of God. Okay? Or number seven, how does a universal regathering of Israel, how can that be fulfilled in the church in any meaningful way? Number eight, permanent restoration to the land given to their fathers. That's a component of the New Covenant. They will be restored permanently to the land God gave to their fathers. The church has no land that God has given to our fathers. Okay. So how can that be fulfilled to the church, New Testament church? Or number 15, Israel and Judah are going to be reunited into one nation. How is that New Covenant component explicitly stated by God as part of the New Covenant? How is that fulfilled in the church? We'll talk about that, the difficulties that covenant theology and the dispensational theology have with the New Covenant further, but that's just an initial observation. The fact that, and this is why listing the components of the New Covenant out, I find so helpful. When you look at it in concrete terms that you can point to in the prophetic texts and say, this is the New Covenant, here's what God has promised, he's promised this, he's also promised this, he said this is going to happen, he said this is going to happen. And when you list them out like that, it becomes much harder to deal with the text in any meaningful way by arguing that that's just it's fulfilled in the church. Second note here is that the scope of the New Covenant is not merely individual. It is national in scope. A distinctive element of this covenant is that it is not merely individual. It is intentionally and explicitly national in scope. That is, isolated spiritual elements may be extended on an individual scale in any era to believers in the Old Testament as to believers in the New Testament. I mean, David already wrote, "Thy law is within my heart." How did that happen? That's a New Covenant promise. But the fulfillment of the New Covenant as promised in toto requires fulfillment on a national scale. Hence, Paul can write, Romans 11:26, "All Israel shall be saved." That's another way of saying, they shall all know me from the least of them to the greatest of them. So the national orientation of the New Covenant parallels the national orientation of the Old Covenant and addresses and corrects the failure of the Old Covenant. So while it is true that a nation consists of individuals, it is equally true that these individuals constitute a national identity for which God expressed an intent as a national entity. And that, again, as we'll see, is made very clear by two back-to-back divine oaths in Jeremiah 31. So to argue that the Israelites could realize the covenant as individuals, that's all well and good, but they cannot fulfill their divinely intended destiny as a kingdom of priests and as a holy nation, if only 10% or 25% or 50% of the individuals within that nation are keeping the covenant. This is something that when it is put in place, when this unilateral, unconditional covenant is put in place, they're all going to know it. And at stake here, and Isaiah 55 especially puts it in these terms, at stake here is divine credibility. The trustworthiness of God's words rooted, I should say, the trustworthiness of God rooted in the reliability of his words as he has spoken them. He not only means what he says exactly what he means. So the Old Covenant was not a covenant establishing or maintaining their relationship to Yahweh. That was unconditionally established by means of the Abrahamic covenant. Abraham's seed is God's people forever by God's own sovereign divine choice. If that bothers you, you have to take that up with God. The Old Covenant was a covenant of divine calling to a unique mission of that people in the world. Ezekiel 19:5-6, Deuteronomy 4:5-8, Deuteronomy 7:6-11, 2 Corinthians 6:32-33. These are passages you can look at to confirm that statement. The Old Covenant was a covenant of divine calling of those people who are already God's people to a unique mission in the world. The unconditionality rooted in the Abrahamic covenant is folded into the Old Covenant. Again, Deuteronomy 28:62, Leviticus 26:44-45. Therefore, promises made to Israel as Israel and not kept for any reason undercut the credibility of promises made to individual believers as individuals. In other words, if God does not keep the promises he made to national Israel, if there are components of the new covenant that just don't get fulfilled, they get left in the dust because all of it, in a kind of general ambiguous way, gets applied to the church. Promises made to Israel as Israel, promises made to the house of Israel and the house of Judah, promises made to the descendants of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, promises made to the descendants of Jacob and David. Promises made to Israel as Israel and not kept for any reason undercut the credibility of promises made to individual believers as individuals. Again, if God does not keep the promises he made to national Israel, on what basis can I be confident that he will keep the promises that he has made to me? If, however, God can work so graciously and so effectually as to keep his promises to them in spite of repeated failure and repeated unfaithfulness, I can be confident that his promises to me are equally reliable. Now, question. If the new covenant is supposed to be the ultimate spiritual solution by replacing the old covenant, by internalizing God's laws, internal enablement to obey, giving one a heart for fear, to fear and to follow God forever, etc. And if we as Gentiles enjoy the spiritual aspects of the new covenant, which I would argue we do, then why do those of us under the benefits of the new covenant still have so much struggle and trouble? I mean, we don't love God all the time. We don't fear God all the time. We don't always experience this internal enablement to obey. We sin. I think there are a couple of parts to an answer to that. One, it is, I think, hard for us to appreciate just how much of an advance in this era, I should say, in this area that we have over Old Covenant saints in the permanent indwelling of the Holy Spirit. Full revelation and other means of grace at our disposal under the New Covenant. We really do have an internal enablement to obey that Old Covenant people didn't have, people who are purely under the Old Covenant. That doesn't mean we always automatically yield to it. Secondly, the New Covenant never promises struggle-free, sinless perfection. It promises cleansing from sin. It promises eternal forgiveness of sin. It promises internal enablement to obey and not sin, sanctification. It promises a new heart, regeneration. It promises the indwelling Holy Spirit. It promises a heart that will not abandon God. That's perseverance as opposed to apostasy. All this and more we possess under the new covenant, but sinlessness, alas, is not a new covenant provision. That awaits the next installment. That awaits the next world. That awaits glorification. Now, another question here that I want to entertain. Don't these eternal promises require fulfillment in an eternal new earth? We talked about several of those components. Israel's eternal dwelling in the land, and their eternal is attached as part of a number of these components. So if they're eternal promises, then doesn't that necessitate actual fulfillment in the eternal realm, in the new heavens and the new earth? That's a question I've been asked a lot of times, and I've thought about it. And I think at least part of the answer to that is this. If you look at Exodus 21, verse 6, which says, if you buy a Hebrew servant, he shall serve 6 years, and in the seventh year he shall go free and pay nothing. If he comes in by himself, he shall go out by himself. If he comes in married, then his wife shall go out to him. Verse 4, if his master has given him a wife, and she has borne him his sons and daughters, the wife and her children shall be her master's, and he shall go out by himself. But, verse 5, if the servant plainly says, I love my master, my wife, and my children, I will not go out free. I want to stay together with my family. Then, verse 6, his master shall bring him to the judges. He shall also bring him to the door or to the doorpost, and his master shall pierce his ear with an awl, and he shall serve him forever. Does Exodus 21:6 require a slave to belong to his Jewish master in the new earth? I think that's a totally fair question and a helpful way to answer this question, because it's exactly the same term that's used, nolam. If you want to argue forever is forever. And if these new covenant components are forever, then they have to be fulfilled for, they got to be in that land forever. Forever is defined by the context. Nolam conveys forever, for as long as the requisite circumstances prevail. You know, if you know anything about this term and how it's used in the Hebrew Old Testament, that forever doesn't always mean eternal into the eons of endless time. Okay. It's defined by the requisite circumstances of the, whatever context it's used in. Often it means forever. Both the Abrahamic and the New Covenant promises are deeply anchored in the land. So forever, I would argue, in response to that question, don't the eternal promises require fulfillment in an eternal new earth? I would argue that because both the Abrahamic and the New Covenant promises are deeply anchored in the land, forever is as long as that land exists, as long as this earth exists. In fact, some translations, the Holman Christian Standard Bible, the Net Bible, use the translation permanently. They translate nolam permanently in connection with the land promises, because they're recognizing those are the requisite circumstances that prevail in that context and how nolam is intended within the confines of that context. Now, I had to cover all of this in order to pause here to say what I want to say next. It is, as I said at the beginning of our discussion of the New Covenant, impossible to adequately understand New Testament theology if you don't understand what the New Testament is and why it's called the New Testament. The New Testament is the inauguration of the New Covenant. Because, as we've seen, the New Covenant is quite a multifaceted covenant. That's why it is surprising and curious to me that New Testament theologies generally have very little to say about the New Covenant. Think about that. A text that is a theology of the New Testament, a theology of the New Covenant, and yet very, very little, if any, attention is given in that theology of the New Covenant to the New Covenant. Even New Testament theologies that reference and discuss the New Covenant typically cite Jeremiah 31:31-34. Schreiner does this in his NTT. Thielman does this in his NTT. Ladd does this in his NTT. They'll reference Jeremiah 31:31-34, but never, ever the rest of the chapter, which is part of the New Covenant. Not to mention chapters 32 and 33, which continue to expand on and explicate the New Covenant, let alone Isaiah 54 or 55 or Ezekiel 36 or 38. I would expect to see a discussion of the New Covenant in a theology of the New Covenant. Some discussion, some reference to these passages. They're not there. Check the indexes. I've done that. Now, let me make very clear, very dogmatic, a very clear, very dogmatic, and very important statement at this point that ought to be obvious to you by now. And that is what I've already said. Jeremiah 31:31-34 is not the new covenant. It's just the preamble of the new covenant. This, in my view, again, is one of the most important points you can take away from this lecture. And in fact, from your own reading of the Old Testament descriptions of the new covenant in Jeremiah, Isaiah, and Ezekiel. The reality is one is hard-pressed to find any remotely extended discussions of the new covenant at all in most NT theologies. I mentioned Schreiner. Same thing is true of Marshall, of Guthrie's. Schreiner is basically amillennial. He converted to premillennialism for a little while when he was preaching through Revelation and got to chapter 20, and he basically announced, I don't know how else to deal with this without being a premillennialist, but it seems that his writings have kind of lapsed more back towards amillennialism now. I. Howard Marshall, his New Testament theology, he's amillennial. Guthrie, he's amillennial. His NT theology has no references to the New Covenant. Frank Thielman is amillennial. Schreiner on Paul's theology. G.K. Beale, who is amillennial, his biblical theology of the New Testament. He has several references to the New Covenant, but the Scripture Index, you've got several references to Jeremiah 31:31-34, but no discussion of anything beyond 31:34. And I bring all those in not just to criticize them. Do you understand how remarkable this is? To write a theology of the New Covenant and yet never actually address the concept, the terms, the passages, the promises, the components, in short, never address the theology of the New Covenant. And I think Mark Saucy puts his finger directly on what I have been sensing for years along this line. He writes, in a book called The People, the Land, and the Future of Israel, it's a collection of essays, very excellent collection of essays. He says it is one of the stunning ironies of academic biblical theology that the entity for which the New Testament corpus is named receives so little attention in understanding the New Testament's theology. Some theologians are more forthcoming, especially among premillennials, but in my experience, discussion of the fuller context and content of the New Covenant is seriously lacking, even in dispensational circles. Even many dispensational premillennial treatments don't venture beyond Jeremiah 31:31-34 in their discussion of the New Covenant. And perhaps part of the reason for that is that if we take the terms of the New Covenant seriously, which you have to do if you're serious about biblical theology, then the New Covenant presents a problem for both covenant theologians and dispensation theologians. So let's focus on the central New Covenant passage in the Old Testament as we work through these problems, Jeremiah 31, and explore the problems that it presents for both covenant and dispensational theologians. This is the section of your notes that should be titled Systematic Theological Obstacles to the New Covenant. The problem of the New Covenant for both covenant and dispensational theology is that both are confronted with explicit terminology in the text that would seem to contradict both major systems of theology. covenant theology and dispensational theology. And to explore this, again, we'll concentrate just on the Locus Classicus, Jeremiah 31. So let's start with covenant theology's problems with the New Covenant. Covenant theology generally has argued that since the New Testament asserts that the New Covenant is now in place for the church, it must therefore not apply to Israel as such anymore. Just as the continuity between Israel and the church is assumed, the application of the New Covenant to the church is the fulfillment for Israel, since the church is considered to be the new Israel. Whether by replacement or continuation or the fruition of Israel, the language varies from covenant theologian to covenant theologian. Here's an old covenant theologian, Matthew Henry. He writes about Jeremiah 31:31. He says, "Observe who the persons are with whom this covenant is made, with the house of Israel and Judah, with the gospel church, the Israel of God." He sees no difference between those terms at all. When he reads the house of Israel and the house of Judah, he sees the church with the spiritual seed of believing Abraham and praying Jacob. Okay. Here's a more recent covenant theologian, Vern Poythress. "With whom is the new covenant made? It is made with Israel and Judah. Hence, it is made with the Christians, with Christians, by virtue of Christ the Israelite. Thus, one might say that Israel and Judah themselves undergo a transformation at the first coming of Christ, because Christ is the final, supremely faithful Israelite." You hear the language. Israel basically is gone. It's done with. It's now replaced with the church. "Around him, all true Israel gathers." Now, Paul argues that Jesus is the last Adam or the second Adam, but he never argues that I'm aware of that Jesus is the last Israelite. Poythress's argument, I would suggest, almost makes sense. It might work if the church had remained predominantly Jewish, or if the majority of Jews converted. But this interpretation seems to me to entail a massive failure of, number one, God's purpose expressed through the New Covenant of magnifying His grace on Israel among the nations, and two, a massive failure of God's determination to demonstrate the precision and the reliability of His words. That, again, most concisely expressed in Isaiah 55, a New Covenant passage. Covenant theology generally argues that national Israel forfeited any right to this covenant by virtue of their unbelief and rebellion, or that because God has merged believing Israelites and believing Gentiles into one new body, the church, the new covenant in its entirety becomes the birthright of that new body. The church now inherits all the blessings of the new covenant. God bears no more covenantal obligation to Israel as Israel. The difficulty with this view is the text of the new covenant itself. Look at Jeremiah 31, 31 to 32. God, I would argue, could not have made it any clearer that He meant national Israel. God specifies that this new covenant is with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah, that it will not be like the one He made with their fathers. That's not me as a Gentile. God never made a covenant with my fathers. He's not talking about a spiritual seed. He's talking about ethnic national Israel. By contrast, my point there is, in the language of 31, 31-32, God could not possibly have made it any clearer that He meant national. What else could He have said to make it clearer that He means national Israel? Just pretend He means national Israel. How could He have said it more clearly? By contrast, He could have said, and this is contextually feasible, if He wanted to, He could have said, "I will make a new covenant with the seed of Abraham," like Matthew Henry interprets, but without any warrant from the text. God could have said here, "I'll make a new covenant with the seed of Abraham." Doesn't say that. If that was in fact what He meant. In other words, if He had meant to open the door to a reference to a purely spiritual fulfillment to a spiritual people, He could have said that, but He didn't. Why is that significant? That's significant because Galatians 3, Paul argues that we are the seed of Abraham, spiritually speaking. Because of, like Abraham was justified by faith, we're justified by faith. We are the seed of Abraham in that sense. If God used that language, you got a good New Testament argument for saying, see, he made the new covenant with the church. That was his ultimate intention all along. He didn't use that language. If God had made this new covenant with the seed of Abraham, we might have considerable, again, New Testament warrant for ignoring any necessary further application or fulfillment to Israel as Israel. But he didn't use that language. And again, while believers are called the seed of Abraham in a purely spiritual sense, by virtue of shared justifying faith in God's words, they are never identified as the house of Israel. They're never called the house of Judah. These are terms specifically connecting their identity to the Mosaic, that is the Old Covenant, a heritage Gentiles simply don't share. Look at Jeremiah 31, 35 to 37. This is the oath. You got the preamble to the new covenant, Jeremiah 31, 31 to 34. Then you have a double oath from God about those to whom he's making these promises in 31, 35 to 37. Then you have a continuation of new covenant promises in 31, 38 and following. Look at the language in Jeremiah 31, 35 to 37. Read that passage. Pause the tape if you need to. Read that passage. God could not have made it any clearer that national Israel, as national Israel, would never be cut off and rejected. Now, how do you get around that? Well, the ESV Study Bible note on this passage says this: God gives a fixed order to the natural creation, and it is just as impossible for the new covenant to cease as it is for the natural order to cease. Compare that note to the text that it's a comment on. And they're like this. Okay. Let me read the ESV Study Bible note again. God gives a fixed order to the natural creation, and it is just as impossible for the new covenant to cease. No, no, no. That's not what God said. What God says, what God swears, in fact, is that it is impossible for Israel as a nation to cease before me forever. God could have said, then the seed of Abraham shall cease from being a people before me. He didn't say that. He could have said, verse 37, I will cast off all the seed of Abraham for all that they have done. But he didn't. In other words, the timelessness of God's commitment is not merely to believers. The timelessness of God's commitment expressed in this passage is to a nation that he will graciously convert into a nation of believers. By the way, this is not a new commitment to Israel in timeless terms. It is a restatement of God's originally timeless commitment to Israel, as a nation, back in Leviticus 26 and back in Deuteronomy 28 to 30. Look at Jeremiah 31, 38 to 40. Okay, you got the double oath in verses 35, 36, and 37. Now you've got the continuation of the promises, the components of the new covenant, in 31, 38, and 40. What's to be done with these very explicit geographical details, which are part of the new covenant? Verse 38 is the northern boundary of Jerusalem. Verse 39 is the western border, though these locations aren't certain, since verse 40 gives the remaining borders. Verse 49 is the southern and the eastern border. God attaches to this spiritually oriented new covenant promise unmistakably explicit geographical language about what he's going to do to their capital city and to their land. The only way the original recipients could possibly have understood these terms. This is part of the original new covenant. Compare Jeremiah 31, 38 with verse 31. Okay. This is all still part of the new covenant. Now, covenant theologians like Kidner or Letch will argue that because Jerusalem rejected her Messiah and was overthrown and destroyed in AD 70, the end of verse 40 of Jeremiah 31, 40 proves that we have to look beyond the present Jerusalem to a new Jerusalem. The problem with that observation is history isn't over yet. For 1900 years, though ethnic Jews continued to exist all over the world despite repeated horrific persecutions and genocidal efforts throughout their history, very few expected that national Israel would become a viable entity again, and yet that's exactly what happened in 1948. Jeremiah 32, verses 36 to 44. Again, we're looking at problems that covenant theology faces when it's dealing with the text of the New Covenant. Jeremiah 32, 36 to 44. Note again how explicitly geographically oriented this is. Verses 36 to 37, he says, concerning this city, this very city that's about to be overrun by the Babylonians, verse 36. And I will bring you back to this place. This is not a spiritual or heavenly Jerusalem that God is describing here. If God knowingly means something entirely different from what he knows they will understand by the terms that he uses, it is really difficult to escape the impression that God is then misleading these people, saying things he knows they will misunderstand and misinterpret. And he's misleading them seriously. And he's misleading them unnecessarily because he doesn't have to add all these explicit geographical details if that's not what he meant. God means what he says, and God says what he means. You say, but didn't God already fulfill this part of these promises when he brought them back from the Babylonian captivity? Well, he has never yet performed a universal regathering out of all the countries where he has driven them. That's a quote from the New Covenant. That is so explicitly and repeatedly asserted in the New Covenant and Restoration passages until its beginnings in 1948. And again, you've got this interesting order in Ezekiel 36, 24 to 25, where God talks about regathering them and then pouring water on them to make them clean. So that's part of the answer to the fact, isn't this fulfilled in the Babylonian return from the Babylonian captivity? No, it's not. Not in the terms that God used to express it. And secondly, the rest of the terms were not fulfilled at the return from the Babylonian captivity either, beginning with Jeremiah 32, 37b. You've also got the specificity of the subjects in verse 42, this people and them. In the context, this is Israel. Okay. Now, to be sure, there was a major dispersal of the Jews after their rejection of their Messiah, the mediator of the new covenant, had they known and received it. In AD 70, the full and final dispersion came after the Bar Kokhba rebellion in AD 136, when Hadrian razed the city of Jerusalem to the ground and rebuilt it as a thoroughly pagan city dedicated to the god Jupiter. For the next 1800 years, the Jews were a people in exile, scattered literally throughout the world with no nationhood and no national homeland until 1948. The promissory terms in this passage are unconditional, they are internal, and they are eternal, and they are never yet performed. One more passage, Jeremiah 33, 19 to 26. Notice in 33:20 you've got the same absolutist terminology. In verse 22, you've got covenant. The covenant made not only with David, but with the Levites. And for a cross-reference to that, look at Malachi 3, 1 through 6, where it is promised that Christ is going to purify the sons of Levi that they may offer to him an offering in righteousness. And by the way, Matthew Henry does exactly the same thing with that passage that he does with Jeremiah 31, 31. Sons of Levi, who's he talking about? The church. Okay. Jeremiah 33, 23 to 24. And 33:25, you got the same absolutist terminology once again. 33:26, the seed of Jacob, not Abraham. And the seed of David will be rulers over the seed of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob. This is clearly Israel. terminology that's never, ever used of believers. Now, a little bit of an addendum here. And we're getting close to being done. It's going longer than I anticipated. What about the modified covenant theology view of the new covenant? More amillennialists are conceding that the Old Testament promises will be literally, physically fulfilled to Israel as Israel in the new earth. For example, in his New Testament Biblical Theology, G.K. Beale writes that the geography of David's eschatological throne at God's right hand is in heaven and in Christ. Nevertheless, he goes on to argue, pages 765 to 766, that these promises, New Covenant promises concerning the land, will be fulfilled in the new earth. Okay. And while this is certainly, I would say, a welcome hermeneutical improvement over the more traditional covenant theological view, I think it still seems to fall short of a very straightforward accounting of several prophetic details. It has a biblical theological problem in that it still doesn't seem to square completely with, one, God's sworn assertion of Israel's reception of these promises as a national entity, rather than subsumed into the church. Nor does it square completely with the fact that the fulfillment will involve the land that I swore to give to your fathers when I brought them out of the land of Egypt. I think there's also a systematic theological problem here. It still seems to concede a defeat for God in ultimately losing this creation to sin and rebellion, rescuing as much as he could before trashing it to start over with a new earth. Now, it may be, you know, there's views about what the new earth is. Is the new earth a totally new creation, or is it a renovated, restored old earth? Okay. Not going to get into that discussion here. That's beyond what I really want to take the time to get into. And as I mentioned, this is going longer than I anticipated. But let me jump to some exegetical issues that I think that view encounters as well. Certain passages seem to require a pre-new creation, non-glorified period after Christ returns to earth in order to accommodate many of these prophecies. Zechariah 14 notes that all the nations are going to come to Jerusalem to worship Yahweh. But, he adds, it anticipates that during this time some are going to refuse to come to Jerusalem. And anybody that does refuse to come to Jerusalem to worship Yahweh is going to receive judgment. How can that be fulfilled in the new earth? This can't be the glorified new earth. Another issue, Revelation 20 requires this new earthly period, this earthly period of 1,000 years. Another exegetical issue, Beale equates the new cosmos with the new Jerusalem, but Revelation 21 seems to see them as distinct entities. The new Jerusalem descending after the new earth has been created. He also equates the new cosmos with the new Israel, which seems to deny that national Israel will truly receive the promises made to her. So, and there's a lot more I could do with Beale. Again, as I say, I think what's happening in a lot of amillennialism is a recognition of a very inadequate treatment of many of the details of these Old Testament passages, these prophecies, and an attempt to rectify that within amillennialism, within covenant theology. And to that degree, I welcome that. I think that's a great, as I say, move in the right hermeneutical direction. I still think it falls far short of what the texts themselves require. But I mentioned earlier that covenant theology is not the only system that has problems with the new covenant. What about dispensational theology's problem with the new covenant? And that's, I purposely made that singular because I think there's only one real central problem that dispensational theology has with the new covenant. Because dispensational theology also has to square up with the full force of Jeremiah 31:31. If the new covenant is cut with Israel as Israel, then how can it be applied to Gentiles and to the church, as the New Testament indicates that it is? I mean, Paul, writing to the Corinthians, says that he describes himself and his apostolic compatriots as messengers of the new covenant to you. They're bringing the new covenant to Greek Corinthians. Okay, how can he say that if the new covenant is not in some sense in force or inaugurated, is the term that I would use here. How can that be, and then in turn, how can that be if the new covenant was made with the house of Israel and the house of Judah? So we got the same problem, okay, in the same text. And Dwight Pentecost, all the way back in Things to Come, back in 1958, outlines three possible dispensational views of the new covenant. One is that there are actually two new covenants, one with Israel and one with the church. That's so problematic, I'm not even going to go into any detail with there, with that. There's no indication, that is a purely systematic theological solution, attempt to solve the problem by saying, well, there must be two new covenants. No exegetical basis for that whatsoever. Second view is that there's only one new covenant and it applies only to Israel, period. The problem is this solution has issues in confronting the New Testament statements that indicate that the new covenant has in fact been inaugurated and that even Gentiles enjoy elements of the new covenant. The third view is that there's one new covenant that is made with Israel, but that God has opened it to Gentile believers. Okay. And that, I would suggest, is the only viable solution for dispensational theology, and I think the one that most dispensationalists have concluded. The first two views preserve the logical unity of the system most consistently, but both are intrinsically weak exegetically. The third view has been the most common dispensational view. It is the soundest exegetically, though it does raise a little bit of a question for the consistency of the system. You still won't have the question, if he made it with the house of Israel and the house of Judah, then how can it apply to the church? And the bottom line simple answer is because God decided he would open it to the church. God decided he would let Gentiles in by faith. And God can expand those promises to anybody and everybody he wants. It's his covenant. It's his grace. They're his promises. That does not mean, however, that he doesn't still have to fulfill it to those with whom he originally made the covenant. He can expand the promises and the recipients of the covenant, but he can't contract or he can't withdraw and say, okay, it's not applying to Israel anymore. Even though I made it with Israel, it doesn't apply to them anymore. It applies just to everybody, regardless, and not especially to Israel, as a nation. In spite of everything that I swore in Jeremiah 31:31-35 that Israel will be, 31:35-37 that Israel would never cease to be a nation before me. Okay, in spite of all that, all the details that are focused clearly on Israel and their people and their ancestors, he can always promise more, but he can always do more than he has promised. He can't do less than he has promised, and that's a concept again we'll talk about more in the next lecture. So, concluding analysis here. The promises of the Abrahamic covenant, notably for our purposes, the universal blessing through his seed, and the overcoming of the failures of the Mosaic covenant are wrapped up in the new covenant. In other words, it is by means of the new covenant that the universal blessing of the Abrahamic covenant and the doing what the Mosaic covenant could not do are secured. The institution of the new covenant is wrapped up in the person and work of Christ. So our association as Gentiles with Christ by faith, making us the spiritual seed of Abraham, Galatians 3, opens the spiritual benefits of the new covenant to all who are attached to Christ, the ultimate seed of Abraham. God can institute it when he chooses, and he can extend any of its benefits to whom he chooses, without abridging or altering the original terms or recipients of the covenant. Now, let me use an illustration. And this has been very helpful for students. It's been helpful for me to kind of work through the details of this. I may not have mentioned, I teach New Testament theology. Been teaching that every year since 2001. Suppose I walk into my New Testament theology class and say this. Let's make it biblical. One of these days, oh my New Testament theology class, I'm going to receive a large royalty check from my books. And in that day that I get that check, in that day I will, out of pure, unilateral, unconditional, celebratory grace, in that day I will, one, give each of you $100. I'm generous, not that generous. Two, I will take all of you out to dinner at Ruth's Chris Steak Restaurant, which if you've never heard of it, which you may not have, it's a very, very high-end steak restaurant here in the U.S. I mean, I'm talking like $65, $70 steaks. So in the day that I get that royalty check, I'm just promising, my New Testament theology class, I'm going to give each of you $100. I'm going to take all of you out to Ruth's Chris Steakhouse, and I will give each of you an A in New Testament theology. That's my promise. Now, the day comes that I announce that I have received my big royalty check. And you, as one of my New Testament theology students, let's say, you start hearing rumors that some of my students in another class, let's say Exposition of Synoptic Gospels, Dr. Talbert teaches that class too, I heard he gave some of those guys $100. And he took them out to Ruth's Chris Steakhouse. What's with that? He hadn't given us anything. He made the promise to us. Okay? I never promised this to the Exposition of Synoptic Gospels class. I only made the promise to the New Testament theology class. But they know I've got my royalty check, and they've heard that some of these students in other classes are getting some of the things that I promised to them. What's with that? Have I been unrighteous to do what I did for my other class? Is it unrighteous of me to give students in Exposition of Synoptic Gospels $100 each and take them to Ruth's Chris Steakhouse? Is that unrighteous? No. I can do whatever I want with my money. As Jesus said, is thine eye evil because I am good? Okay. I can expand, I can extend the promises to whomever I choose. Here's another question. Does that mean my original promise has been fulfilled? Not till you've gotten $100. Not till you've gotten taken out to Ruth's Chris Steakhouse. Okay. But here's the deal. There's one thing that I haven't done and that I can't do for any of my Exposition of Synoptic Gospels students. I can't give them an A in New Testament theology. New Testament theology is a core course. If they haven't taken New Testament theology yet, they still have to take it. They don't get an A in New Testament theology. I can't do that for them because they're not in New Testament theology. That is a class specific promise. You follow me? That's a promise that I can only fulfill to my New Testament theology students. Similarly, some of, in fact, I would argue most of the terms of the New Covenant are Israel specific promises. They're things that he can't do for non-Israelites because it makes no sense. How can he give non-Israelites the land that he gave to their fathers when he didn't give non-Israelites any land? Now, the parallel would be to the New Testament. New Covenant would be even closer if some New Testament theology students, a few, say the Jewish classmates among them, had received $100 and had gone out to Ruth's Chris Steakhouse with me, while others, for whatever reason, hadn't yet. That parallels the situation because when Christ inaugurates the New Covenant, there are lots of Jews who become beneficiaries of this, but they don't get all of the benefits of the New Covenant yet because the New Covenant is necessarily nationwide in its ultimate fulfillment. So that third, just like the third promise, the A in New Testament theology, that can't be fulfilled until the eschaton of the semester. Okay? Just like the Israel-specific promises, the nationwide nature of those promises will not be fulfilled until the eschaton, when God finally brings all of this to pass, when Israel as a nation is converted, all Israel will be saved, Romans 11:26, and they are brought, restored back to their land, and all the covenant promises are fulfilled to Israel as Israel. So, here's the principle. God can always do more than he has promised, but he cannot do less or other than he has promised. In other words, the fact that the new covenant was made with Israel does not mean the benefits cannot be extended to others. It does mean that it must be fulfilled as stated to those to whom it was made. At the heart of how we interpret the new covenant is the trustworthiness of God's character, not to mislead in the terms he uses. The reliability of the words as stated, and his ability to bring to pass precisely what he has promised. God not only means what he says, he says what he means. Given the fact that there were individuals then within national Israel who did believe and did embrace Messiah as the personification and the fulfillment of the promissory covenants made with Israel, it's only logical that the new covenant would be officially inaugurated, initiated, set in motion for the benefit of those Jews, just as certain messianic prophecies that predict elements of both the first and the second coming are not partially fulfilled, but fulfilled in part or in segments, like the Isaiah 61 passage we talked about earlier. Moreover, the initiation of the new covenant was essential at some point in history to fulfill and make effectual all the truth promised and symbolized under the old covenant. At the same time, if the words God uses mean anything, if all the repeatedly emphasized Israel-oriented terms of the new covenant are to be taken seriously and given their straightforward grammatical historical force, then it must be that there awaits a future and full realization of this new covenant for national Israel as national Israel, including the political and geographical details that are repeatedly underscored in the new covenant's various prophetic affirmations. So, is the new covenant fulfilled? Is it inaugurated? Yes, at the Last Supper in the upper room. Is it initiated? Yes, at Calvary. Is it fulfilled or consummated? Those are words that I would prefer to reserve for when all the promises that are part of the covenant have been accomplished for those to whom they were made at the second coming of Christ. Inasmuch as the object of the new covenant is Israel as Israel, the new covenant as a whole remains unfulfilled then to those to whom it was originally promised. Inasmuch as the inauguration of the new covenant was announced by Christ and explained in Hebrews and verified by Paul in various places, inasmuch as that anticipates, however veiled, anticipates Gentile inclusion and includes elements now in force for some to whom it was promised, as well as for many to whom it was not promised, the Gentiles, but not for all to whom it was promised yet, the entire nation of Israel. It is in force, the new covenant is in force, it is in process of being fulfilled, though ultimate, that is full and final fulfillment, awaits the eschaton, awaits a future date. Now, couple more, we got about 5 to 10 more minutes. I'm sorry this has gone so long. I didn't mean for this to get out of control here. But let's talk briefly about the relationships then between the covenants. Just wrap this up with this discussion. Let's start with the relationship between the Abrahamic and the Mosaic covenant. What's the relationship between these two covenants? First, Israel's identity as the people of God was not dependent on their obedience to the Old Covenant or the Mosaic Covenant, nor even on their reception of their Messiah. Their identification, their identity as the people of God is settled by the Abrahamic covenant, a unilateral, unconditional covenant where God said, Abraham's seed is my people forever. As Galatians 3:17 argues, Israel's failure to maintain the conditions of the Mosaic covenant could not abrogate the previous unilateral, unconditional promises of the Abrahamic covenant. Nor can it abrogate subsequent, later, unilateral and unconditional covenants. The failure to observe the stipulations of the Mosaic covenant, then, could not terminate God's covenant relationship with Israel as his people for several reasons. One, God's whole covenant relationship with Israel was rooted in the previous unilateral, unconditional, covenantal act of God binding himself to Abraham's seed. Two, God consistently referred to Israel as my people even before the covenant was initiated, the old covenant, the Mosaic covenant. Third, the Mosaic covenant never promised that Israel would be his people as long as they kept the covenant stipulations. Rather, God promised that if they obeyed and kept his covenant, then they would be a special treasure to God, a kingdom of priests to God, and a holy nation. And as such, they would serve a mediatorial function between the true God and the rest of the nations. So in short, as covenant theologian John Murray himself writes, what is conditioned upon obedience to the Mosaic covenant is the enjoyment of the blessing which the covenant contemplates. Second, the Mosaic covenant functions as a vehicle of the promises contained in the Abrahamic covenant, necessitated by the transition of Abraham's seed from nomadic family clans to nationhood. McComiskey writes regarding this, the law is not the promise, it is a covenant distinct from the promise covenant. The law is the temporary framework that prescribed the terms of obedience for the people of God in the Mosaic era, and as such, functions in conjunction with the promise covenant. So the Mosaic covenant incorporates and extends several promissory features of the Abrahamic covenant. The Exodus events that lead to Sinai, nationhood, and the Mosaic covenant itself are rooted in the promises of the Abrahamic covenant. The promise of offspring, the promise that the Lord will be God to his people, the promise of land, the promise of divine blessing for Gentiles, muted but present. Okay. So then why the law? Galatians 3:19 raises that and answers that question. It was added because of transgression, until the seed, singular, referring to Christ, Galatians 3:16, should come to whom, that's a singular pronoun, the promise had been made. 3:21 then, is the law then contrary to the promises of God? God forbid. 3:24, the law was a guardian, a protector, and a trainer until Christ. Now, what about the relationship then between the Mosaic covenant and the new covenant? The Mosaic covenant is a conditional covenant. If you will obey, then you shall be a special treasure, a kingdom of priests, and a holy nation, Exodus 19:5-6. It spells out the necessary conditions in order to fulfill their divinely intended calling. The new covenant is an unconditional covenant. And I'm pulling my language here from 1 Peter 2:9-10 because I think that's a passage that really intriguingly, it's the mirror image of the reverse mirror image of the Mosaic covenant in this sense. Here's what Peter says. Let me go back to the Mosaic covenant again. If you will obey, then you'll be a special treasure, a kingdom of priests, a holy nation. Here's what Peter says. You are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, his own special people, in order that you may, or in order that you should, display the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light, who once were not a people, but are now the people of God. It spells out the necessary calling in order to fulfill a divinely intended destiny. In a sense, then, the old covenant is the new covenant with no grace, which is why you have proleptic references to the need for the new covenant, even in the Mosaic covenant, Deuteronomy 30. So it is as if God declares in the Abrahamic covenant, here's what I'll do for you and for the world through you, Abraham's seed, Israel. Old covenant, here's what I expect from you, Israel. Not as a condition, but as a response. And here's what is required to accomplish it. Davidic covenant, here's how I will mediate my covenantal rule and my purposes for you. And in the new covenant, here is how I'm going to accomplish my original promises, Abrahamic covenant, via the ultimate seed of Abraham, by internally effecting the appropriate response and providing what is necessary to fulfill God's expectations. That's the Old Covenant, Mosaic Covenant. Mediated through the ultimate Son of David, Davidic Covenant. I'm trying to package all of that together under the aegis, under the mechanism of the New Covenant. And in conjunction with that, you've got this chart of these covenantal interrelationships. The New Covenant is the means by which all these other covenants are actually accomplished. So you've got, and ignore the blank box that's above that. That's another discussion we're not getting into. But you've got the Abrahamic covenant that kind of feeds in a way into the Mosaic covenant, that feeds in a way into the Davidic covenant. All those are connected, and the new covenant is the mechanism that pulls all those, or that accomplishes all of those. You could think of it this way. You could perhaps envision the new covenant as the engine of a train that pulls the cars of the Abrahamic covenant, the old covenant, the Davidic covenant to God's intended destination. That's lecture one. Okay? And I hope you'll come back, join me for a much shorter lecture. I anticipate about an hour to 75 minutes. For lecture two on a dispensational case, making a dispensational theological case for the fulfillment of the new covenant to Israel as Israel. We'll get into the discussion of covenant theology and dispensationalism and how they interpret the new covenant in a whole lot more detail than we have already in that next lecture. So hopefully see you next time.